So I guess I can go ahead and start by introducing myself. I'm Timothy Nietering. I go by Tim, and I'm 20 years old.
My name is Chase, and I'm 30 years old.
You can just look at Timothy.
Oh, yeah.
Sorry.
It's okay. What mental illness do you have?
I have anxiety. And I was diagnosed when I was,
diagnosed at 5 with ADHD.
Diagnosed at 5 with ADHD. It's been, my father was diagnosed with depression, and he took his own life. So it's like a hereditary thing in my family as well. So what's your day like?
My normal day-to-day is pretty much waking up. I had cystic fibrosis. I wake up, I do morning therapy treatments of an inhale of 2 to 3 inhaled medicines. One's an antibiotic, and then I do a chest therapy. It's a it's also called a vest. It's something where I can where I put it on, and then it fills up with air, and then it with the tube it retracts and pushes the air back in, kind of doing like a vibration type motion to vibrate the mucus in my chest, so not to help break it up a bit more.
Okay.
So I can try and cough it up, since I have a mass amount of mucus that's just sitting in my lungs, because like others, I can't really get it all out and everything. So.
And if you don't have your meds, then it's pretty painful then day.
I cough a whole lot and everything, and it can just be really uncomfortable wise for me, because then I'm just coughing and my throat can get sore, and because of how hard I'm coughing, I can bruise my ribs sometimes.
Oh wow.
And everything, just I always make a joke that I don't need to do sit-ups to get a six-pack. I just need to cough, because when I'm bending over and coughing, sometimes I have that I have the thing of like where I'll accidentally throw up some mucus and or food if I had something to eat before and everything, because it just like it puts so much muscle strain on the stomach area and just like the whole area that it can so I always make that joke of like I don't need to do setups, I can just cough. And
must be a lot of tension on your body then.
Mm-hmm. That's why it is. It's why I'm trying harder to eat more and everything, and try and exercise more, so I can build up actual muscle, because I don't have a whole lot of muscle as it is, and because of my CF affects the lungs and the digestive system, I burn through more calories someone my age and height would. So I have to eat, I think it's 2 times or 3 times more calories a day than someone my average height and age would. Just because I'm burning through so much calories a day, because my body's constantly fighting and stuff, and when I'm coughing.
Oh wow. Yeah, I'm kind of in the same boat. I need my medication, or my whole thoughts are gonna be racing. Like for me, my illness kind of affects me in the way that I move pretty. That's why I'm probably so thin, is because when I'm feeling anxious, I just want to like go, you know what I mean? Mm-hmm. Like run out of my skin. My day, it's like I have to wake up pretty early and give myself time to do meditation. That's how I kind of keep my illness in check, I have to take a time and kind of like analyze myself and see what thoughts I have coming at me, and kind of like through meditation I can get rid of them and treat myself, so to speak.
Talk about your beads in your hand.
Yeah, this is a mala to help me count my breaths and stay focused.
Okay, so that's kind of like a therapy to help.
Yeah, it's like it's like a therapy that you can do yourself, so to, you know.
Okay.
What's the end of your days like? Like, how do you guys conclude your day? How do you wrap up your day when you're about ready to go to bed? I mean, what is it like?
I do have to meditate. That stuff, like meditation at the beginning of the day and like at the end of my days is how I do it for 30 minutes in the full lotus position.
No, normally the end of my day sort of ends like the beginning, to where I'll do each treatment takes about 15 minutes, and then sometimes if need to do a bit longer, we'll add to it. And then I either decide to get on my computer and play video games that help me kind of finish off any, because it's, like I was talking about too, even with CF, you have that mental illness type stuff of anxiety and depression and stuff like that. And video games kind of helps me kind of let loose and kind of,
yeah, I love video games too.
Yeah, I'm pretty. The only struggle I have is I'm on there till 3 a.m, but that's because I'm just turned into a night owl, and it's because of the way that my lifestyle went to. Because like I was saying, I was diagnosed when I was 6 years old. How it went about is Halloween, I was kept in from class recess because I was coughing and everything, and I was like throwing a fit and temper tantrum. And when it came to Halloween night and everything, my mom ended up carrying me for the whole Halloween, and then we drove to my grandmother's house to trick-or-treat there for our last place, and I was just looking paler and paler. So the November 1st was, I was taken into the, normal pediatrician, and they were like, couldn't immediately see the normal doctors, and so they noticed my fingertips were blue and nails were blue, so they gave me a bit of oxygen and a, asthma inhaler type thing, because they, at the time too, they were thinking I had just, like, bad asthma. So after being, that, they said, do you feel comfortable taking him to the hospital yourself or be transported in an ambulance? So decided to be transported in an ambulance, or not. I was taken in my dad's car there. He called my mom and so on and so forth. And after found out I was diagnosed and started to be on a better path and everything, I tried. Because when I was a little kid, Power Rangers was a huge thing and everything. You had Dino Thunder, and the main person's name was Connor. It's like, my middle name's Connor. I should play soccer too, so I can be like the Red Ranger. So I decided to play soccer, and it was too much of a workout for my lungs, and I just really didn't enjoy it, because and in the summers, in winter too, I was coughing. I was coughing a bit more because in the summer the weather's a bit more, or the air is a bit more heavy, and then in the winter it's a bit more light. So I just sort of normally stayed inside and sat around and played video games, because it was just so much. And just did nothing and watched TV sometimes and read, because it didn't put any strain on my breathing and stuff like that. So I always like, so now because of that and everything, I have to kind of push myself out of that mentality of keeping myself from not doing anything that strains my breathing, because I have to push myself to be able to exercise more, because I just decided not to.
Yeah.
Because I was like, I didn't want to, because it was too much strain. It's why too, when I was much littler, I didn't eat meat a whole lot, because it upset my stomach and gave me stomach pain. And as soon as I hit middle school was when I started to be more adventurous with food. I'm still extremely picky with vegetables and stuff, because I have a texture thing.
Yeah, I can't eat vegetables either.
but I was like, you know, I can actually start to eat meat more, because I pushed out of that afraid zone of, like, if I eat meat, I'm going to hurt my stomach.
Yeah.
And everything is just kind of, we have our own strides, I think, as it pushes forward. Granted, we're always going to have that kind of, like, pushback of, because we're just always set in that zone of, like, we've done this so long for so many years. And when you try to push forward, I mean, I know you can agree too. You probably tried to push yourself out of your comfort zone a bit.
Yeah, all the time.
And then you'll just have those one of those days to where you just have to, like, kind of hop back a bit, back to what you initially did before, and kind of readjust your thought process and try and put it into a different way.
I always try to find ways to challenge myself as much as I can. And, like, you know, for instance, like, I used to be terrified of driving cars. Mm-hmm. That was, like, a huge focal point of anxiety. Like, any time I would have to get, just to go to the store, I would have to make sure, okay, do I have my medication with me? Or is, like, how's the, you know, what time of day is it? Is traffic, you know, going to be busy? So, yeah, but it turned out, like, at my job, I work for a car rental company, mm-hmm. so I have to drive, you know, cars mm-hmm. all the time, and I can't be anxious about that, or I'm going to have an accident, and it's going to be trouble, so I have to kind of use, like, my meditation abilities to like, check myself emotionally before I hop in the $100,000 Camaro right. and whip it around. I have to have everything, like, lined up the right way, because I can't, you know, you don't want to be held hostage to fear. So how did people, like, react when you were diagnosed with your illness?
My family was definitely surprised. Like, my Aunt Joanne was talking about when we were in the main studio and everything. And after that, it kind of just was like, if there's anything we can do to help and everything, they just kind of was like, if there's any information, they asked for it, and my parents gave it. And my I know when my mom, when I was first diagnosed, my mom got a book and everything, and every page that she, like, every few chapters she read, it talked about shorter lifespan and everything, and it was making her extremely emotional. But as soon as we got to my first clinic visit from for the CF clinic, the pulmonologist there was just immediately said, don't worry about what the book says, just throw it out. Of course, she didn't throw it out because it's a book and everything, and
yeah,
had some decent information, but said, don't, as long as you keep them on the regimen of making sure they're taking all their medication, and doing their treatments like they're supposed to, they'll live as long as they possibly can and everything. Because there's going to come a point in time to where my lungs that I have right now will probably be beyond repair of just doing my medication and my treatments, to where I'll need a lung transplant, in which case I won't have to do a lot of the medication that I'm doing mm-hmm. For my mornings. I'll just have to do my stuff for my digestive. But I'll be adding a new one to one or two, just to make sure that the lungs wouldn't reject. And then there's also a thing down the line coming to where I'll have to start doing stuff for diabetes, just because my pancreas doesn't work. So I take enzyme replacements to help digest food for me. Pretty much, if I'm willing to go a day worth of for each day, I'm probably doing... See, when I'm on cycle for an antibiotic, I do 2 inhaled medications in the morning. I do 4 of my enzymes, my 2 vitamins, a Zantac for acid in the morning, my allergy medicine, and then another antibiotic Monday, Wednesday, Friday. And that's pretty much my morning pill intake. And then plus, like, the 2 inhaled medications. And then, yeah, the enzymes I take each time I eat a meal. I take 4 with meals and 2 with snacks. The 2 is for like a lighter load because I'm only going to have like a snack. And, you know, you're not really going to eat a snack in a huge, like, long span of time.
Yeah.
So, but some of my friends, they didn't really, like, they just shrugged it off like, okay, and everything. The workplace, I tell them and everything, and they just say, some places are just like, okay, just let us know, if there's anything else, if you need, like, extra, break time or something like that. I have some people when I tell, like, there's gonna be some people, that'll have like a normal like cough to try and clear my throat out in public, and I won't immediately tell people, but they'll just think like, oh, he's sick and got something contagious and everything. But I just have shrugged that off now because it's just happened so much. I had to figure out if I'm comfortable with someone or I'm working at the time where I'm having like one of my coughing spells. I'll go like, I'm not, don't worry, I'm not sick. I just have cystic fibrosis, so I'm just clearing my throat and everything.
So people act kind of like apprehensive, yeah. Like, ooh, so, I don't want to. Yeah, there's
sometimes, yeah.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, there'll be sometimes where if there's another cashier, they'll go to the other cashier because they don't want to. One thing that makes it difficult sometimes, especially when I was littler, is if I wanted to spend the night at a friend's house, I had to lug my huge vest with me and bring medicine, bring like my own medicine with me to do in the at night and then in the morning. So it always made it hard for like if we wanted to do like travel anywhere too, because we always had to make sure we had the room to fit it in there and stuff like that.
So you had to gear up a lot to just for a little sleepover.
Figure when I was after my senior year of high school ended, I got for the longest time I didn't use the Make-A-Wish Foundation because my parents didn't think I might not have qualified for it and everything. And then just like after finding out why I went in the hospital for like a checkup type thing because. I was coughing a lot more and I had like a infection that needed like IV antibiotics. They said if you wanted to hook you up with the Make-A-Wish Foundation, you just got to get your application in before you turn 18. So I got that in and everything and decided to go to Gettysburg because I'm a history buff.
Oh, me too.
And I really liked the Civil War, so just said, don't worry, we got all like the proper stuff for you to like bring your medical stuff with you if need be. So we hopped on a plane, got my vest loaded up and medicine where it needed to be, and got to go there for a whole week and everything. So it was the first time I ever actually rode on a plane, because just one, because money partially is a thing, and then two, just always the fact of where are we gonna stick my medical equipment.
Oh wow.
So what about your what happens when people tell you that when you tell them that you have, like, anxiety and stuff?
Well, honestly, you know, for the most part, I do have to say that your average person is pretty sympathetic, because there's been so much more awareness that has been brought to the public. So a lot of people are pretty sympathetic and understanding, but every so often you will get the rude, inconsiderate person that's not very educated about, you know, how mental health works. So you will have to kind of deal with a few funny remarks. Not nothing. I've never really been maliciously attacked before, but some people at the workplace, when you tell them, like, I got to take my meds. They're like, oh, you got problems, huh? Like, you know, just some people just like to kind of joke and jab about it. But for the most part, I would say that everyone's pretty, like, kind and sympathetic. Like, my boss has been very accommodating, and I'm very lucky that I have someone that is willing to, like, work with me and not stigmatize me. Yeah, I've had to overcome a lot in my job because I was so, like, scared of the environment and everything. And, but yeah, I was able to get through because of, like, all the support that I've been given. So I've actually quite recently had a pretty, like, positive experience with other people's reaction. And it really makes me happy that it makes me realize that my mom has been making a difference in our community.
Chase, can I ask you, how did you get diagnosed? How did your family find out you had anxiety and this issue?
Well, that's kind of like a pretty long story because, you know, I was first diagnosed with like ADHD in my younger years. So,
You know, I think when you have mental health, so many of the diagnoses, they all parallel with each other. Mm. So you can go from ADHD to Asperger to nonverbal learning disability to...
Yeah, see, I've been it's confusing for me because my diagnosis has shifted so many times. At one point I was ADHD, which I totally, you know, get. But then on the other hand, I had Asperger's syndrome. And I feel like I kind of grew out of that because Asperger's syndrome is kind of like you're shy socially and stuff. And I don't really like feel that way. For the most part, I love interacting with people. So I really never saw like how that one was relevant.
Yeah, there's just been from day one we knew something. And then it was, you know, at about five, once he started kindergarten, he actually went to what was called the pre-primary impaired first. He had 7 years of physical therapy because of muscle weaknesses that he had. His anxiety started young, having the fear of talking to people. He would carry probably 5-6 books with him at a time because that was his comfort. Reading, remember all of that?
Chase? Yeah, I remember that.
Yeah. So it really wasn't until his dad died and we, of anxiety-driven depression, that we really started looking at the history, and there were several generations of that. So we really needed to start looking at, okay, this anxiety, and then, you know, with suicidal thoughts, suicidal actions, a lot of times anxiety comes from that, so... So he's come so far. I mean, like, I think he's, you know, he talked about driving, the anxiety with driving. He got his license at 25.
Yeah.
Which is actually not that uncommon. Mm-hmm. I just want to point that out. That's not that uncommon. So.
Right. I mean, people are waiting longer, but it's the anxiety that really comes and takes control. Mm. But, you know, I mean, you see, like, he's found, though, ways to cope with his beads, with his meditation. So
yeah, that's, you know, like I don't really feel limited by my illness anymore because I feel like for the most part I have like transcended a lot of it because I'm not nearly as like wild and out of control as I was when, say, like high school time. Because I've kind of realized like it's all in your state of mind and you can, you know, control it.
But it takes a lot.
Yeah, it has to be, like, maintained, like, doing any sort of, like, physical workout or activity, kind of like lifting weights. You have to just work your way up.
But I think it's interesting because you said, too, how you, like, sometimes just need a break. Mm-hmm. You know, we'll have a family get, like, Christmas or Thanksgiving or just a Sunday afternoon, and Chase has had enough after a certain amount of time, and he just needs to go in a bedroom, shut the door, and be by himself.
Yeah. You know,
isn't that all of us, though? I mean, quite honestly,
yeah. But he does it, though, you know, where he knows I can't too much stimulation, too much.
Yeah, I know exactly, like, when I've had my point and, like, I just need to go.
I know, certainly in the winter sometimes, I definitely have, I see myself have a lot higher, somewhat anxiety stuff myself. And I've partially admitted it and everything, because there's been some times where I've had, when I was at my one, when I worked out one job, and I was just started to have like a visible panic attack that I saw because stuff just was getting out of hand, and I pretty much tried to do what I could to keep myself visibly okay and everything. And then as soon as I got home, I let my parents know that I'm going to be on probably till 3 o'clock tonight, because they not want me to be in bed by no later than 1 if I do hop on my computer. And I was like, I'm going to be on till 3 tonight, just so you know, because I had a bad day at work and everything. And it was something that I was like, I didn't want to fully, I knew that it was there and everything, and because they started to give out these things at the beginning of each doctor's visit at the CF clinic that you fill out. And it's like a depression type thing and then a anxiety type thing that they have you fill out, and it's on a 0 to 5 scale and everything like you would at a normal doctor's visit, because they want to check up on that type of stuff. And at the point of the doctor visit, it's not really all that. I haven't had one in a while, and I'm feeling good and everything. And then it's just like, it's all of a sudden, it can sneak right up on you. And I know that it can happen with you too and everything. You can be like doing extremely well, and then all of a sudden one day it can just immediately shoot you down, and
yeah, it'll be right there. Yeah, it doesn't take much, you know.
Because, you know, like at a family gathering too, I even had to, I don't know why, but just for some reason I started to feel like antsy or something. So I was like, and I knew my parents didn't like me to put my headphones on and everything, because I was trying to do what I could, but I just finally had to put headphones in and listen to music and everything and kind of calm myself down, because yeah, it's just appears out of nowhere.
I need music all the time to like get myself grounded again too. And just, in fact, whenever I'm in my house just doing stuff, I have headphones in, because I can just get so much, I feel so much more comfortable. You know, like, it kind of makes me anxious when, like, the neighbors are, like, banging and clanging around. Mm-hmm. So, like, I love the safety zone that, like, headphones and music provides.
Mm-hmm. I did a whole lot of, there was one point where I was scrolling through, Facebook, and I came upon this one thing of grounding, and I was like, that's why I watched the video about it and everything. And it was like, it was there was a study by this doctor and everything over in California and everything, of how since we've became like so insulated because of the shoes and silicone and stuff like that, that there's been like a lot more rise of like the anxiety, depression, and inflammation and stuff like that. But like, they did a sleep test with a lot of people at a university, where they put like copper wires on the bed and everything, and that was attached out to a thing outside. And they noticed, like, in the people that didn't have it, there was like a much higher inflammation type thing, but in like the people who had like the copper wires leading outside, that there was like that the people got better sleep, and they woke up with less inflammation in their legs and stuff like that. Oh, and wow. They felt a lot more refreshed. So it's like, there's like been a rise of like what was called like grounding, like people have grounding mats they can put on their desks that have just like a copper type thing, and like they created special shoes that got like a it's kind of like, they look like the sandals that like the Greek or Japanese would wear, and it's got like a copper piece on the bottom that would like have the energy from the earth kind of help go through the copper and through the body and everything. It's like, and I was like, that's something that I've had an interest in it and everything like that, but it's not something I really thought about. Like, so then after like going and reaching that, like, I know that meditation and stuff works, and that's partially part of like grounding and everything. It's like, it's going to be, it's interesting, and I want to like look more into it and everything, because it might be something that can help me.
I would
help
yeah.
others, or even help my brother in some cases, just because I know he's always looking for some stuff like that.
Yeah, it's really cool, just, and it's so simple too, and all you have to do is just stick with it. Like, I do very simple just Zen meditation practices, which is just counting the breath mm-hmm. and all the way up to 10. And once you do that for, say, like X amount of months, then yeah, it can really like transform you. Just being able to take a step out of our normal frame of consciousness mm-hmm. and go somewhere else. So you're clearly on medication for mm-hmm. your pain. Does it feel like it helps you?
Yes, it definitely does, in a lot of ways. Because CF is somewhat like it's like a more compressed version of asthma, to where it's you're always gonna have that like slightly compressed breathing tube and everything, and so doing the inhaler in the morning kind of helps like widen it a bit, and then I do like another inhaler too, and then have the inhaled medications that I do through a nebulizer. Each one does a different thing. Like and one of the medications was found out actually back in 2007 in Australia, because that's a place that a lot of people with CF are actually prevalent and everything, and a lot of them surfed, and they said after surfing and everything that they were feeling like their breathing was a bit better, so they started to go into a test with the salt water, and they found out that the salt water actually helped with CF and everything.
Oh wow!
Pretty much they have it now in like a 7% type form. So pretty much the way it works is the 7% kind of, when inhaled, it kind of wettens up the mucus a bit, kind of get it to where it can somewhat move, and then have what's called palmazine, which is kind of like a pair of metaphorical scissors in a way. So when you breathe that in, it'll actually go through and snip up the mucus, kind of making it much easier to cough up. And with the vest, it'll actually vibrate the chest more to get it be able to move a lot more. And then there's this one, then I'm on like an antibiotic every 28 days called Toby. And that's can either be inhaled through a nebulizer, or they have what's called the Toby Podhaler, which is one where it's kind of like it's got like powder, and then it's in these little four packs of pods. And there's one for the morning and one for the night. And you breathe each pod in, and that's kind of like just an antibiotic to go and kind of help try and heal the lungs a bit and everything. So in doing all those kind of helps definitely keep the cough and kind of it helps make it better, but doesn't immediately make it go away, because it's better to cough when it's not so violent. It's much better, but when like just still like even having a cough to kind of help cough up bit by bit helps every little bit and everything, because not coughing at all just is it's why like I can't take like any of like the decongestant type ones, like the DM type medications, if I'm like wanting to take like a cough medicine or something like that, because they want me to cough to help cough to bring stuff up. But something to help kind of lessen the cough doesn't, that is fine in general. Because I know there was one time where I was, where the CF doctors put me on mucinex for a cough one time. When you're a lot younger, too, they kind of, like, try and parade you with antibiotics. Because with the mucus being in the lungs, a lot more susceptible to illnesses. Like, if, say, like, I was with next to someone with pneumonia and I were to get it, and that person was, like, better the next day, I would get put in the hospital because of it, because I would have a much worse reaction to it. That's pretty
frightening.
Mm-hmm. When I was, I don't know if my mom told you the story of when I was put in the hospital, but when I was laying in the bed next to the person, the mom across the room was, like, looking at my parents, like, because they were thinking I had pneumonia at the time. And everything, too. So the mom was like, scowling at my mom, thinking that I was going to give her kid pneumonia and stuff. When it turned out, he had pneumonia. And I just was, and I was just in there to be diagnosed with my CF because I was having a, because I wasn't able to breathe and everything. Wow. Mm-hmm. It's sad to see sometimes because you'll have, like, so many people, it's much easier now because you can be diagnosed a lot earlier and everything. I haven't seen I haven't seen 5 Feet Apart at all, which is a movie that was put out that kind of brought CF to Hollywood with Cole Sprouse and whoever it was playing the other person and everything. I've been meaning to see it and everything because I want to kind of get my own take of it and everything and kind of see, like, if what it because it brought up a whole uproar in the actual CF community and everything. People were like, that's not, and people were just, like, throwing a fit about it and everything. It's like, just, it's a movie. It's made by Hollywood. It's trying to bring something towards, delight. It made the CF community actually put out a note, that even though that, it's, like, bringing up a thing of, like, you can be no more than 6 feet apart from each other if another person has CF and everything. Don't try and tilt the line because it's for your own protection. The only way that someone with CF can beat another person with CF is if they don't have, if they've had, like, the lung transplant and everything, and they're, because people with their normal lungs and people with CF are a danger more to themselves, for both of them, than they are to a different person, because they can get each other sick much easier. And that's the sad part. It's like my parents, whenever they had, like, a family education day, they was like, we want you to, we would love to, for you to meet these people that are like speakers and everything, but they just can't because they can't take a chance of another person with CF being there and then risk chance of getting both people, both me and the other person in the hospital, possibly. Yeah, so with CF, it's a lot. There's a lot to it to where, like with two people with anxiety and everything, they can kind of just, like, they just kind of sit there and kind of possibly make each other worse if both their anxieties get worse, or they can help each other cope.
Exactly.
Is that true? Does that happen?
Yeah, I would have to say that, like, people that have, you know, mental illnesses, when they come together, it can either be extremely healing or it can be very, you know, destructive, all depending on the state of mind.
What kind of myths do you deal with? Do you ever deal with misconceptions about anxiety?
Oh, yeah, in my earlier years in, like, high school, I've dealt with a lot of misconception. I really, not so much about my illness, but more of, like, about people's reaction to my father's death. That was, like, that really is what brought my attention of how, like, misinformed people are on the subject. Just you know, people would, like, make fun of me, tell me that, like, my father's crazy, so therefore I'm crazy, sort of stuff like that. And that's what kind of led to me, like, not really being so open about, like, my whole family history, my own illness. That's kind of like, whenever I meet someone new, it's very hard for me to, like, discuss that. I really have to like, analyze the person and see if this person is receptive to that sort of info, so to, you know. So yeah, it was kind of, yeah, earlier lots of misconception.
Do you think those misconceptions are a little less now because we're more open to talking about
this? I would say now, like, there's way more, people are way more, like, friendly and way more approachable about, like, mental health. Like, if I need some time off, my boss is very, like, accommodating with just kind of letting me go. And yeah, I didn't, you know, in some places people aren't always like that, but I've been very blessed with finding, like, a very tolerant and understanding atmosphere.
What about the medications that you take? I mean, you mentioned earlier that you do take some.
Yeah, I take Buspar, which is kind of like a milder version of Xanax. And I would definitely say that it really has made a profound impact and in a positive way. Mm-hmm. It takes a while to find, you know, the right medication, but for me, that one has definitely been exactly what I needed. If I don't take, you know, my meds, then I'm just pretty much, I'm going to be hit with, like, an excessive amount of adrenaline that isn't going to, like, go away. It's kind of like, it's just like, it's so intense. It's kind of like you just want to, like, run out of your own skin. That's how, because, like, all I know that I'm having, like, an attack when, like, I just keep, like, fidgeting and moving. I'll be all over the room. That's when I know, like, it's time for me to take a moment and to check myself.
So is it primarily then, it's primarily the meditation, and then you just take the one medication? Is that?
Yeah. What I like to do is I like to meditate without any medication so I can truly experience, like, myself and, like, my natural state. And that way I know, like, what I need to work on for, like, the day ahead of me. Mm-hmm. So I like to be totally holistic. And then once I take the medicine, I can kind of, like, look back on what I was, like, worried about or stressed out about while I was meditating and kind of, like, totally brush it off. So pretty, like, in-depth self-analysis.
You guys jumped a question that I was kind of interested in hearing from both of you, but do you, and let's start with Chase, do you ever feel limited by your illness at all? Do you ever feel limited by it?
Honestly, like, no, I don't, because, like, I know that, like, I can take, say, that energy from an anxiety attack, and I can channel it to, like, a higher purpose instead of using that restless energy to freak myself out and be afraid. I can, like, go for a really long walk and sweat it out because I know I have, like, that much adrenaline in me. So as long as I can find, like, the proper creative or physical outlet for me to release that, you know, steam from a panic attack, I know I'll be fine. So it's really just...
But it's taken a long
time to get
there. Yeah, and I think that's... it sounds like you've gone through a tremendous process.
Yeah.
You know, like, Timothy's gone through a tremendous process to get to this point. You've gone through a tremendous process.
Very long, long journey.
Can you explain a little bit or give us a little bit about how that process went through?
Well, after coming back from China for 5 years, I went through, like, a tragedy of losing my best friend to a drug overdose. So that kind of inspired me to really want to, like, study the human mind and the human nature and to protect myself from, like, various bad habits or any form of like neurosis and just become strong. So I really got into like meditation as a way of just protecting myself from all like the troubles and the trials and tribulations that we come across in modern day society. And it hasn't been something that I did overnight. It's taken me like, I've pretty much devoted my whole life to meditation and like Buddhism. And after fully applying like all those principles to my life, I feel like it's given me like my own inner core of personal strength that I can like call upon when I need to overcome like any obstacle.
So in the summer, definitely just because of how heavy the air can get sometimes, especially when it's extremely humid, and with how humid we get here because of the because of us having all the lakes around and everything, that being like that warm and sticky, the air becomes extremely heavy. So it's kind of always when we get to those high like 80s and 90s, I always just try and stay inside whenever I can, because I don't wanna, granted I don't cough as much as I probably should and everything because of it, which is good. My breathing just becomes like a lot shorter and everything, and it kind of keeps me it kind of stopped me from wanting to do a whole lot of stuff outside like I was saying. So I'll just kind of like stay inside, and I'll either watch videos, read, or I'll just sit and play video games all day. But I think now, because of after being out of school and having to work in those conditions sometimes, it's like it kind of forces you to push forward and persevere through it, which helps you kind of lessen that hindering. And when you can kind of start to get a better breathing format and just kind of keep pushing forward, it won't become so much as a hindrance. Whereas if I was to, I would say I still won't exercise, because that would just be too much and everything, but every day-to-day task, being done outside, I'll probably be able to do a bit more. So yeah, just really like when the weather changes, definitely is, it's there, because I know my coughing kind of takes up more of a perseverance and everything. So I always try and make sure I bring water with me or wherever I go, because it just keeps, that way I can keep myself kind of having water intake and kind of help keep going through what I'm going through for my day-to-day basis. Yeah, because I know like this past winter and stuff, when we had that struggle of wanting to be winter and then going back to spring and then going back to winter. Yeah. And it was just the whole, whenever I had to go outside, I was coughing for that immediate change, because it's like, that the pollen that was like being, wanting to come out and play and be used to pollinate, and then just immediate, least shot back down because of the snow.
Yeah, that was rough.
Did that have any impact on you at all? That change in that violent change in seasons?
Not. I really don't get bothered by like the I worked outside, so just that physical aspect alone was pretty bad for like everyone that lives here, but I do get pretty afraid, just driving on that ice. That's always, automobiles are a huge source of my anxiety. So like definitely like waking up every day and seeing like that blizzard everywhere made me pretty afraid.
So So you're afraid of automobiles, but you work for a...
Yeah, I work for a car rental company. So, like, I really had to, like, it was sink or swim. I mean, my driving, I'm either going to, like, make it work or I'm going to be out the door. And luckily, I was able to build up my driving ability to the point where I'm as natural with the car as I am on my own 2 feet, I would say. I don't mind driving at all anymore.
But that's kind of that's a huge, I'm sorry, Timothy, but
that's
a huge, like, jump. I mean, did you just kind of just apply for the job knowing that?
Yeah, I was kind of like, I just got back from Thailand and I kind of like needed a job. And that was like the first one that came my way. And it was just kind of like, oh, you're going to be, you know, driving cars for 8 hours, so you better. And yeah, at first, like, I didn't really think it was going to work because I had a few accidents and it was just kind of scary. But I just kind of went all out with my meditation and my mindfulness practices, and I applied that to the work environment. And I found that, yeah, like, I can, you know, get through this. It's just all in the state of mind that I have, and not to rush myself is the most important thing that I learned, and to just always be, like, mindful and aware and see, like, the whole, you know, the whole window of perspective. So, yeah.
Mm-hmm. See.
What does the prognosis mean?
When I looked that up, I was like plan a route going forward.
Like, what's the prognosis of your illness, or what's the prognosis? Like, how do you move forward? What do you do?
You guys, I think, kind of covered it. Both of you kind of covered that one. Mm-hmm. So, what about Timothy? Why don't you ask him the last question?
Yeah, the plans for the future.
You know, I've never been one that has had very, like, far-reaching, ambitious goals. Like, I just want to be happy and just get through life, you know, just keep working and just enjoying the little things, because life is so, you know, precious. You don't want to, I don't like spending my time being, like, greedy and everything. I really just,
I agree with you. It's, you know, because I always think about, because one movie that kind of took me into, like, wanting to look more in Japan, I know it's stupid, but Kung Fu Panda and everything, not really mainly, like, the Kung Fu part of it, but just Master Sho, the one turtle that was there, he was just so wise and everything, and he, and that one quote that's always said, don't ponder about... don't ponder about the future because it is untold. Worry about the now. That's why it's called the present.
You got it, man. You got it, bro. Yeah.
The future is nice to think about and everything, but in some cases where it comes to, like, me and or you, it becomes a point of why worry about the future when you already know, like, a set point ahead of what can happen. Worry about the path going forward and try and curvate it so you can avoid that possible future and make it a alternate reality.
Stressing about the future, you know, can take up so much time and emotional energy, and then you find yourself like, why was I even, like, stressing out about such a thing? So for me, I just like to day by day, you know, get through my illness and help other people. That's just kind of what I would like to do.
I have a question for the two of you. I mean, just because we're kind of at the end of this, but I'm just wondering, through all of this, have you, either of you, learned anything from the other person about what they deal with or what they face, or similarities?
I've seen that, like, kind of, well, this has made me realize that kind of, like, mental health is no different from, like, physical health. Like, when you know, because our illnesses kind of, like, affect us in, like, the same way. Like, he can't really go outside as much, you know, depending on a certain, like, and it's kind of like the same way, like, when my condition is affecting me, like, I don't really want to leave the house or, you know, so it can, both of our illnesses can kind of, like, put us at a distance from people.
Yeah, no, figure, I know, I've always, from you, I kind of learned of, like, the importance definitely of meditating and everything. That's always something that I've thought about doing, but I've just never really, just because of how, late I sleep in and everything, and I've been meaning to try and get better at, waking up early and everything, and it's kind of brought a light of maybe it might actually be a lot better and everything and help me actually going forward, too, because then it might possibly help my actual physical health, because not only is it, my physical health, the thing at, effect, I also have that mental part that's hidden in there sometimes that'll, definitely, play with, how my health goes too, because I know there was one time where I was feeling like I was in like a bad I had a bad relationship type thing, whether it be friendship or just actual relationship, and as soon as that was kind of cut off, I started to see a rise in my actual health come back up and everything. Yeah.
It's kind of strange how, like, once you correlate your mental health, then that can, like, help you in your, like, physical, too.
Mm-hmm.
It's just our state of mind is so important, just to always have, like, a positive state of mind.